been over almost 2 years since I made a video talking about everything you need to know about Sandbox. But it's 2025, and while we are waiting for a release date to come out, a lot of things were added over the years that you probably didn't know. If this is your first time hearing about Sandbox, or you're just refreshing your memory, here's everything you need to know about it. First off, what even is Sandbox? Sandbox is a game engine slash platform that is developed by Gary Newman. Yes, the same one that made Gary's Mod and his team at Facepunch. They've been developing this game for over 8 years now. And while the game is in a much better development state and structure with its current systems, its history has felt more like developer hell in some cases. The game originally started as a prototype back in 2017 in Unity, which came from a collection of games called Tub, Stars, and Wise Guys. They then moved over to Unreal Engine 4, which is really hard to find gameplay of. But in March of 2020, Gary announced that they've switched over to the Source 2 engine. Now let's clarify some misconceptions about Sandbox. Gary has officially stated that Sandbox is not a mod, and it's not Gmod. While it takes some motifs from Gary's magnum opus, Gary's Mod, on the website it states it's a spiritual successor to Gary's Mod and a love letter to Source 2. While most folks will still call and say it's Gary's Mod 2, Gary also states that they also don't have the license to use Valve's assets, only the license they got specifically for the Source 2 engine. So basically, Sandbox is literally the only way currently that any game developer has to using a quote unquote Source 2 SDK, until Valve decides to release it themselves, which is going to be a long while. A reason for the quotations is due to how heavily modified this version of the Source 2 engine has gotten over the years, basically to a point where it's not even recognizable anymore. Another reason Sandbox exists today is due to two things. Number one, Gary fixing the things he regret when making Gary's Mod, and number two, to create an engine that he and his studio can call their own, essentially creating an engine that they can use for their own games down the line and moving away from Unity, and is probably going to be the next engine for Rust 2. And while there is still some traces of the Source 2 SDK tools, with every future update, Facepunch is taking out the time to remake and integrate these tools directly into the Sandbox editor from scratch, which leads us into our next part, the editor. Creating thousands of games is the forefront of using Sandbox, not only as a platform where you can play thousands of games and upload them to, some good and some bad, but also stitch together a game engine that's readily available for you to create whatever game your developer mind desires. I decided for this section to get some help from a well-versed and also known community Sandbox developer named Fortune to assist me in talking more about some of the really cool features that are a part of the Sandbox editor when making games. But you can also skip to the other cool non-game dev stuff too if you're not into it. Let's break this down into sections here, starting off with iteration speed. Sandbox is currently one of the nicest engines to iterate on right now. Changes to code can compile in seconds and scene startup almost instantly. Sandbox also has an inbuilt hot loading system that allows code changes to be made during play sessions, allowing you to tweak your game in real time as you're testing it in order to make faster changes with minimal friction. Next, for networking, Sandbox has built-in first-party networking support, as it's very intuitive, clean, and easy to get started with. Plus, there's an inbuilt way to test this within the Sandbox editor, allowing you to start multiplayer sessions and join them with a click of a button. With the Sandbox Cloud, Sandbox has a built-in community-driven asset library where community members can upload many assets like models, materials, shaders, maps, prefabs, and more to an online database you can use in your own games throughout the platform, which allows for easier access to an extensive library of assets for quickly prototyping, setting up environments, and sharing your creations. Familiarity is very important to some people, and Sandbox uses an entity component system akin to Unity, allowing for a simple transition between engines if you want to try it out. According to Fortune, since Sandbox is much newer, it has corrected many of the API issues they had with Unity, following the official C# guide lines and code formatting and naming conventions. Plus, it also runs on the latest version of C# and .NET, giving access to excellent modern features of the language. With editor tooling, Sandbox features a very powerful API for creating editor add-ons, allowing the community to create and share libraries of editor tools that aid in the creation of games. Fortune also added a note saying the documentation for this currently sucks ass, but once you get past it, it is very powerful. The sandbox editor does provide a wonderful suite of tools that I think many developers who have used or mess with Unity will find right at home with, as the purpose of the sandbox editor is to provide speed, efficiency, and a simplified workflow that gives you the ability to create games no problem. One of Sandbox's latest features was its recent addition of adding human player models. While for years the face of Sandbox has been Terry, and most likely will be, a very disturbing looking sausage avatar that was created due to Gary's, well, more interesting philosophy on human characters that are found in games nowadays, and also due to old British animated shows from the 90s and taking some inspiration from a British show from back at least in the 70s or 80s, which by looking at all the game contestants, they do have a very interesting look to them. I'm just going to say that. A part of the controversy Sandbox has, aside from its push away from a lot of the Valve assets and mod background, was the creation of this avatar, as for years it was a quote-unquote placeholder, and then Gary mentions it was going to be removed officially in a blog post, to then never seeing the removal of the sausage character as Gary decided to troll in Gary fashion. Very classic Gary. But moving on to the new player models comes with a new avatar selection screen. This is the same screen where you can not only choose which avatar you want, but also customize them too. At the time of this video, this is a work in progress looking at the new customization page. Regardless, you can customize your character and also look at some of the other pieces of clothing that you probably don't own yet. I just want to add to this, since many people do ask this question, but you are able to create your own custom characters to use for your games or if a game on Sandbox allows it. It's a game engine after all. Gary decided to create Sandbox specifically for developers and creators to get paid for the work that they provide. It's the mantra of what Sandbox is all about, not only just providing players and developers a platform to make and play games on, but also an engine you can use to create those games and have a chance of making a living off of it. This ties into the Play Fund, which is a way for Sandbox game developers to get paid for their work. The way the Play Fund works is dependent on how many active players your game has. So if you're the most popular game on Sandbox for the next couple of months, that means you'll get a lot of money since people can't stop getting enough of your game. Gary mentions that this way of monetizing is best without encouraging each game to add microtransactions and encourages people to make games that people want to play rather than making games that extract money from you. Of course, as many of you are furiously typing in the comments right now, well, what about all those scammers and exploiters that want to abuse the system? Gary has had that in mind, as he mentioned in a blog post that these people will be dealt with as they gather information using a secret algorithm running in the background to discourage this type of behavior. There's a whole blog post which is linked in the description if you want to learn more about it. I definitely recommend it if you want to take Sandbox seriously as a game developer. The next part is probably going to be mixed for some folks, but it's actually another aspect that can help out creatives who contribute to Sandbox. The Sandbox Market, or basically, Sandbox's Steam Marketplace, is essentially just cosmetics anyone could buy to make their characters look cool in game. Many folks know of this system that's been used within TF2, CS2, Dota 2, and more games. And it's also used in Facepunch's own game, Rust. But the best part about this cosmetics system is the integration of greenlit community made cosmetics, so the creators can get paid from making them when they're available on the Sandbox store. This ties into Gary's model for this game, which is to correct the mistakes he made in the past when he created Gary's mod. Gary decided to add this cosmetic system into the game as a way to provide revenue for Sandbox, noting that eventually he'd want Sandbox to become self-sustainable, specifically from sales and cosmetics, meaning that most likely Sandbox will cost money to purchase at a set price, just like Gary's mod was, which we'll talk about later in this video. And this next one is probably the best-selling feature specifically for Sandbox itself. One of Gary's biggest issues with Gary's mod was being unable to allow developers who made game modes on Gary's mod to export them as standalone games. And while its biggest problem most likely was due to engine limitations at the time, this time around, Gary has decided to start from scratch and create a system that allows basically anyone to create a game on Sandbox and then export it as a standalone game to put on Steam directly, completely for free, no royalties, wild stuff. This is an insane feature to have on something like Sandbox, as while Facepunch and Gary have gotten a license for the Source 2 engine from Valve, it seems like Valve absolutely loved the idea of them essentially creating a usable version of the Source 2 SDK, as I mentioned before. Gary and Facepunch have been in talks about the system for at least what feels like 2 years now since it was first mentioned, and while there has been some info here and there, there really isn't much newer information as of this video that confirms that it would be available, well, yet. But the system itself is in Sandbox and basically ready to go, it's just disabled from using since Valve and Facepunch lawyers are probably communicating more on how this would go about and how it would be used. Alright, so yes, the one thing I know many people really care about and only want to get Sandbox for is the Sandbox mode itself. So the Sandbox mode was originally in the developer preview when I had gotten access back in 2023. But of course, it was removed as it had been rumored to getting reworked again. This would make sense since down the line, the editor moved away from the source-styled entity workflow to the current Unity-styled scene workflow. That meant it'd have to be reworked and remade again. Gary had mentioned the Sandbox mode back in November of last year on the very first post when the Sandbox Steam page went live, stating that they know people expect an official Sandbox mode created by Facepunch for the engine. And while they have been weary about it, they thought about it for a while. And they thought of some new features that would justify making it, so they are actively working on it in the background. And as a bonus, they will not release Sandbox until the official Sandbox mode is done. So in short, they're currently working on it and won't release the game until it's finished. So if we do see any sort of updates on the Sandbox mode, that would also mean that we're incredibly close to Sandbox being released. The biggest question many people ask is, how much is Sandbox going to cost? While many have speculated that it'd be better to be free to play to compete with games like Roblox and Fortnite, it seems like this won't be the case, as while it would be a free to play game, would be great for everyone, it comes with its own slew of problems like hackers and exploiters. But it seems like Sandbox is more than likely going to be a set price. Probably the same price as Gary's mod, to be exact. And Gary has mentioned that the biggest issue that they'd have with making Sandbox free to play is quick mass adoption, making it probably difficult for the servers or other backend stuff if they're not prepared for a massive influx of players. But paid would seem like a good choice to prevent some of these issues, and at the same time also allow Sandbox to be a step closer to self-sustainability. As of right now, most of the funding for development on Sandbox has come directly from copies sold of Gary's mod. Personally, I feel Sandbox could be a great alternative engine and platform for people who want to utilize its editor as the closest way to make games using the Source 2 engine. There's many features and aspects that could make it appealing for some game developers, and of course gamers like myself that love not only indie games but also a game platform like this to play possibly endless amount of games down the line. While many could see it this way, oddly enough, Gary mentioned that he's not trying to compete with Roblox, but creating an engine and a platform that many people can make the games they want, but also make a living off of too. It's the ultimate dream for many, and we'll have to see if Gary and his team at Facepunch can probably pull this off and live up to its title of a spiritual successor. If you'd like to know more about Sandbox, check out this video here talking more about it, and thanks for watching.